Right. So what I'm going to cover is just an overview of the Automata products and the data processing. So in this talk, it's going to be a little bit of a parallel effort between some slides and also a little demo actually using Hype. So to take you through how to reprocess Spire data, when you go into a Hype session, there's already a set of scripts available for you to use. What we generally recommend is that you use these user pipelines. So these are the three main Automata mode of the small map, large map, and parallel. And these have scripts already provided that you can go through to reprocess data. And then there's all two spectrometer pipeline scripts for you to use. Now, for certain uses or advanced users, you may want to use the actual scripts that are run in the environment here at ESAC. So these scripts are already provided, but need a little bit more of an effort to use and a little bit more tweaking to use. However, they do mimic the real processing done here. There is no actual difference in terms of the steps done on the data between these scripts and these scripts, at least there's not for the Automata. So when you've actually selected a script, this is the window that you see. This is a small map pipeline script. So you will have three things here that you have to fill in. You will have to fill in the ops ID that you need to reprocess. If you want to reprocess from some local data, then you'll have to enter what's known as the pool name. And then you'll have to enter the path to where the data is that you want to store the output. The options down here are if you want to include the turnaround data, you can set that to true. This is set to false because in the user script, the user script at the moment is really set up for reprocessing point source pipeline. And you generally only use this for the extended source pipeline. And then this is a toggle between using a median baseline subtraction or what we almost always use now and generally recommend to use, which is the DStriper baseline subtraction. And then we have the ability to turn on a jump detector, which can flag where it detects jumps. Generally, that detector is switched off for most reprocessing purposes. And again, that's a bit more of an advanced option. Then if you just scroll down your script a little bit more, there's one other thing to pay attention to, which is where you get your observations from. So by default, the script is set up that you get your observation from your own data pool, which you've named up above. However, if you don't have a data pool yet set up, what you can do is toggle it over to getting the observation from the HSA. So what I'm going to do now is leave this demo and actually go into Hype. And just go through this option and load a small pipeline script here. And you can see there's a lot of header at the top. And then I will need to edit these parameters. I already have an ops ID set up, so I'll just copy that over. Now, what I'm going to do for this demo is I'm actually just going to comment this out and not define this, because I'm going to use the HSA to get my data. Now, I happen to be running this demo on a Mac, therefore my path will look very Mac-like. But it's just a standard place that you want to store your data. When you install Hype, you'll have a local store by default. And here in this demo, I'm just using this default place for the local store. If you want to change that place, you can put a property in your user props file to change that, but this is just the default location that comes when Hype is set up. Okay, so I've set these three things. The other thing I have to do is just scroll down to this and change the OBS ID to get that from the HSA and not from the local store. And then I just press these two double arrows at the top just to run everything in the script. And you'll see that it starts off by reading the calibration. If you don't have the calibration installed, what you can do is uncomment out this line and load a new calibration tree onto your system, which you might need to do the first time. So while that's running, I'm going to go back to the presentation. Now, Andreas showed you the sort of top level look at the photometer pipeline. What this diagram shows is the slightly more detailed version of the photometer pipeline. So what we have are these level 0.5 products. Now, all that level 0.5 is just the raw data from the detectors with the effects of the instrument electronics removed. So all of the amplifiers and analog to digital converters are just calibrated for, taken out, and instead of having counts, we have faults. So that's all that's in the level 0.5 products. To run the level 1 processing, we actually concatenate the timelines from the individual scans. We then run an electrical crosstalk correction, which just corrects between the bolometers on the arrays and then two special bolometers, which are basically for misters taking temperature all the time. And that corrects the difference between those. We flag any for mister jumps. And then we run a wavelet deglitcher, which looks at glitches which hit more than one detector at once. And then those are filtered out through the first level deglitching. There's an electrical filter correction, and then we correct to the flux density. So that just converts straight away from faults into Jansky's. We remove any temperature fluctuations. As I said, we're continually monitoring the array temperatures via two thermistors on each array. And then we associate sky positions, re-separate the timelines, and do the time correlation, which is just a correction for the spacecraft clock on board. So by level one, you have calibrated timelines. These are now in Jansky's per beam. Filtering has been done in terms of trying to make the baselines as fast as possible. So these are ready to go to use to actually do photometry. However, we also then go on to construct a map. For extended maps, we apply relative gains. So these take into account the slightly different beam sizes of the different barometers. Do another baseline removal, and then the map making. This just over here shows the pointing part of the chain, where we do actually have to take into account the fact that we have a beam steering mechanism inside the photometer. That, for all intents and purposes, is actually in a fixed position, but any jitter that is taken into account inside the pointing product. This is just again the slide that Andrea showed you. Just to go into this, extended calibrated maps. The only difference is that we now take into account these different beam footprints from the different detectors, which we don't need for the point source calibrated maps. And then we just divide by the beam area to get into megajanskis per stir radian. And then from Hype 10 onwards, we now do this cross calibration with the Planck maps and look at the offset between the Spire background and the Planck calculated background, and then apply that offset. So this is just a summary of the Planck calibration, where if you take a HFI map, it needs to be color corrected towards the Spire maps. The Spire maps are convolved with the Planck beam, and then you determine the offset and compute a difference map. Then there's another iteration where the Spire map is embedded, the full resolution Spire map now is embedded with the Planck map, and an offset determination is made again to finally compute the offset that you need to apply to the Spire map to make it absolutely calibrated according to Planck. So this is a case of a Spire map, and this is now what it looks like when it's convolved with the Planck beam, so that you can see that the resolution is a lot worse, but it gives you that overall offset across, gives you the same map as Planck, so that you can calculate the overall offset across the map. And this is a single number that you apply to the whole map that we're calculating. So this is, for comparison, the Planck map for that convolved Spire map, and you can see that the two spacecraft data agree very well indeed. This is the embedded map, and that's the embedded plus convolved. So what I'm now going to talk a little bit about is the useful scripts that are present in the Spire in area of Hype. And I'm particularly going to talk about the photometer useful scripts. So the first useful script is the astrometry correction script. And what that is useful for is if you're looking at combining more than one map and you think that the pointing of the two maps is out, what you can do is sort of run a cross correlation between the maps and correct the astrometry for one map onto the other map. There's a baseline destriper script. As I said, the destriper is the default way of correcting baselines for Spire. But this script presents different ways of correcting baselines should you want to choose a different method. There's a barometer finder script which plots the detectors and data passing through a specified pixel if you think you've got an issue with a particular map pixel and you want to investigate it deeper. This is one way to go. There's an ephemeris and solar system position script, and that will show you the start and end positions on a map of the moving target from the solar system on the Spire map. This is sort of the equivalent of a level 2 point source map. So there's also the solar system map where this is already corrected for. There's a map merging script which allows you to merge two point source calibrated maps together. A zero point correction script which allows you to run the zero point correction for yourself. As I said, the user pipelines at the moment only work with the point source corrected maps, calibrated maps. And then there's a script that I'm actually going to go through a little bit later, which shows you the different methods available for doing point source photometry. All right, there's also a solar system motion correction script, which allows you to run the motion correction for yourself. This is basically the same method that's used in the pipeline. And then there's a super resolution mapping script, which allows you to reprocess maps where you have high degrees of coverage through the high res algorithm to improve resolution. Okay, so I'm now going to cover just a few of the issues we sometimes see with maps. So one of the issues is sometimes you get a very small map that looks like this with not much coverage. That's just where sometimes if you observe a large map with a single scan, you will just get a brush of the sky like this and there's nothing you can do about it. For bright sources, you do sometimes see the effects of the telescope inside the maps. And the telescope support structure. That is, again, something, in a sense, you have to live with. Some of these bright sources were also observed in bright source mode, where the effect is a lot less. Then we come on to issues with baseline subtraction. If it is done using the median signal, this can lead to striping in the map. That can be helped by using the destriper instead as your baseline subtraction. Occasionally, we get these thermistor signal jumps. So they give strange patches in the map, as you can see. Not a lot can be done about these patches, so I think the easiest way is just to reject the affected data. But they usually only affect a small part of the map. Another issue, and all of these issues I should add are actually quite rare. So the vast majority of Spire data is not affected by any of these issues. But it's just occasionally we see some of these. So another one is if a thermistor, so this is gauging the temperature of the detectors the whole time. If this hits a rail, you can see this kind of striping across the map because the temperature drift correction has completely failed in the processing. You can reprocess the data using the other thermistor. Each detector array comes with two thermistors. However, PMW array, only one of the thermistors is working. So if you come across a case where this has hit the PNW array, there's not a lot that can be done. I'm not actually aware of any cases where that's the case, but we may have missed one or two. Another issue is the a glitch that hits all detectors at the same time. So you see this sort of pepper pattern where each of the detectors is hit by the glitch. That just needs a little bit of manual processing to go in and remove that glitch yourself, because for whatever reason the data processing hasn't picked it up. And then we have another issue, which is that up to 8 hours after a cooler recycle, we have a little bit of instability in the temperature of the detectors. And about 8 hours after the cooler recycle, the temperature of the cold tip of the cooler actually goes through quite a rapid change of temperature. And that's shown by this rapid change here. And that rapid change is reflected directly into the detector data. And what happens is then the timeline correction has trouble coping with this sudden change of gradient. And you sometimes see these kind of effects in the map. So since then, we've implemented a CoolAvert, as we call them, corrections. So if you set the CoolAvert detection equals true at the beginning of the user pipeline script, it will apply this correction to the map. Finally, there's SPIA, which is the Spire interactive analysis. This allows you to reprocess Spire data using a GUI rather than through the pipeline script that I showed you earlier. You can get this as our Hype plugin, and the information is provided here on the website to go to get the information on how to install SPIA, if that's the way that you prefer to reduce your data. So coming back to my Hype session, my observation has now finished running. You can see that I have these populated. I've got a nice little map appeared here, and my script says completed processing of this ObSci-D. So that's the end of this talk, which shows you the basics of how to reprocess Spire data and what may be in a map. So I'm happy to take any questions at this point.
Yeah, we haven't received, thanks Tania and Andreas and Ed. We haven't received any questions yet through the chat, as far as I can see. But this would be a good time for anyone in WebEx, just for either type your question or unmute yourself and pose your questions, if you have any. Okay, otherwise I have a question. I don't know whether maybe you will cover that later. What would be the recommendation for photometry to make photometry of point sources on molecular cloud images with Spire? Because there are these two types of calibrations that you've mentioned, the point source calibration and the extended source calibration. But what kind of map is recommended to be used if you want to extract point sources over an extended background? Because this is some kind of a...
I would still recommend using the point source calibration if they're point sources.
Okay, so even for molecular cloud science?
Yes.
Okay. And what would be the recommended algorithm for extracting point source fluxes for such maps?
It's always the timeline fitter.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Can I intervene here? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
One point I would like to make also is that the timeline fitters would have the ability to remove sloped backgrounds.
Yes, they do.
So it should be possible to use a timeline fitter and allow a tilted background to be subtracted when in such a case. So that's it.
Okay, thank you. There's another question from the chat, which is, which of the corrections mentioned of the SPIRE photometer data are applied at the SPG pipeline, and conversely, which are applied only to the user pipelines?
Actually, there's no difference between the two pipelines.
Okay, so they are identical.
They are identical. The user pipeline, the difference between them is that the user pipeline scripts have a lot more comments and are laid out in such a way that it is suitable for an interactive user with the hype session to go through that script and change parameters within that script in a user-friendly way. Whereas the SPG scripts are set up for running on an SPG environment inside the HSC, where data is run through parallel processing, and these scripts are tailored towards that kind of they're highly tailored to run very efficiently in a multi-threaded way. So I would always recommend that users use the user script.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. That I think this answers the question very well. And so the last question we got on the first day, generally for all data, and then I'd like to ask you for particularly for the SPIRE photometer data, is what approximate fraction of the products in the archive in the SPIRE photometer mode are potentially usable directly usable for science analysis without having to reprocess, and how to tell when they are not?
Almost all of the photometer products are at that stage.
Okay. So it is then. So, but I guess in case of that, there are, for example, cooler barbs not corrected for automatically, or some
yes.
a fraction of the observations might still have problems, but you say most of them are ready to be used.
Yeah, most of them are ready to be used. It's the issues I showed only affect a very small fraction of the maps.
Okay. So that's very good. That's very good. Yeah. Thank you. Is there any other question from anyone in the WebEx session? Okay, yeah, there's one more. So for searching solar system objects, I would like to check the exact time UTC of the measurements in a scan leg detector scale. How can I reach it via height?
It depends on exactly what you're trying to do. The time of the map is given in the metadata, which you can see in Hive, and I can show you that in a minute. For solar system observations, inside the solar system useful script, you can directly extract the start position and end position with the start time and end time of the map, and the script runs you through how to do that. I'm not going to cover that this morning because that's a little bit advanced for this workshop, but that's how you do it.
Yes, so what we would like to advise the Erika is whether you can send a help desk ticket with specifying which exact observation you are or observations you are analyzing, and we can give you more detailed description of how to access those times.
Yeah, I'd be happy to give a fuller description via a help desk ticket.
And anyone else, this applies to anyone else as well, either something you learned today or something else, just let us know via help desk. Any kind of questions are good questions, so please let us know any questions you have through the help desk as well. So, final call for more questions. Otherwise, maybe we can go to the next block of the morning session.
Okay. So let's just get the right presentation up. Okay. So this is a little bit of a short presentation and a bit more of a demo. So this is the spire photometry, how to do it. Basically, you are able to do either point source photometry or extended photometry. But wrapped up in that is also the issue of source extraction. So I'm actually going to start up in this top right hand corner here, where let's say you want to do point source photometry, you've got a map full of sources, but you don't know where those sources are. So the first thing that you want to do is actually run a source extractor. We have two source extractors available in Hype, SUS Extractor and DAOFOT. SUS Extractor uses a sort of Gaussian fitting algorithm, which is actually the type of algorithm that we recommend for Spire data. DAOFOT uses an aperture-based algorithm, but both of them will return lists of sources. Both of them will also return the source flux. So if you're happy to run SUS Extractor, get the source flux, you don't actually need to go any further. For sources brighter than 30 millijanskis, you can run the timeline fitter. Now the timeline fitter works on level 1 data instead of level 2 data. Now remember, level 1 data is all the detector readouts still in their timelines as the detectors drift across the sky. But in units of Janskis per beam. And the advantage of using the timeline fitter over the map data is that to go from the timelines to the maps, you're already resampling your data into map pixels, and then you're trying to do photometry by doing photometry directly on the timelines. You have a lot more data going into your fitting. This is also basically a Gaussian fitter, but just using the timelines as the input rather than the maps. You're using a lot more data into your fit, and therefore you're getting a more accurate fit. So overwhelmingly, the timeline fitter is always the fitter, the way of doing photometry that we would always recommend. Also available in Hype is Spire aperture photometry. Now that does not give as accurate results as the timeline fitter. However, some people may wish to use it, so it's there available. For extended sources, probably the best way is to use the aperture photometry that is in Hype. And there you can just define your aperture that you want to perform photometry over and the aperture for your background determination. In terms of photometric corrections, depending on exactly what you do, you need to do different things. So this chart kind of lays it all out. So I'll start on the left-hand side with the timeline fitter. That just runs on these D-stripes level one timelines. That gives you a flux. However, that flux is the inbound flux for our photometer with this mu F nu baseline. So that needs to be color corrected according to the spectrum of your source. And there is a full table of color corrections provided in height to allow you to do that. Soft extractor being also a Gaussian fitting method, basically that goes down through the same path. It gives you flux densities in millijanskis, and those need to be color corrected. Now the two aperture based methods, VAO and the aperture photometry, the recommendation for those methods is to start with an extended calibrated map. However, you do have to then make a correction for the color corrections between point source and extended source maps. And that's what we call KP2E. So that correction needs to be done. And then you need to convert that into a point source calibrated map using the convert image task in HIPE. So that then gives you a map in jaskis per pixel. And then you can run your aperture photometry or DAOFOT with aperture correction equals true or aperture correction equals false. So what the aperture correction is a way of correcting for the fact that the spire beam is actually more extended than the aperture that you're going to use. So that is a factor that makes that correction. If you use aperture correction equals true, you don't need to worry about it. You just run DAOFOT and then run your color correction. If you use aperture correction equals false, you also then need to further do a beam area correction, and that's the same correction that you need to run if you run aperture photometry. Of course, all these results still need the color correction, and then there's another aperture correction on the flux for aperture photometry and the DAO if the aperture correction equals false as well. At the end of this, all of these you will get either millijanskis or janskis in the particular case of the aperture photometry. Now, I know this sounds rather complicated, but I'll take you through the user script in a minute that does some of these so that you can show in a practical way how to just run these tasks. So this is just a little bit about the K-P2E. So what we need are our conversion factors to transform between the inbound fluxes to monochromatic flux densities. And these are referred to for the point sources as K4P and for the extended maps as K4E. So when we convert from extended to point, we actually use the ratio of these, which is the KP2E. Now this table shows the table 6 in the SPIRE Data Reduction Guide, which gives you all these factors for the SPIRE bands. And coming back to the Data Reduction Guide, and I will show you this briefly in a minute, there is actually a little table that shows all the tables that give all of these parameters in the data reduction guide, so that you can go and look up, particularly for instance, the color correction. You may be wanting to look up the color correction for your particular source. You will need to go to table 6.13. So that's all I have to say on that. So I'm going to just come back to doing this in a kind of practical way in a hype session. I'll try and make this a bit bigger. So I've just reprocessed my small map. If I press help, I'm just going to use the online help here. I can go to this fire data reduction guide, and this is the chapters that I want. And in this, there's a photometer mode cookbook. I'll expand it here too. And under that, you can see there's a chapter which is recipe for spire photometry. And this basically just gives you all the details that I've just given you here with all of these tables with the beam area, effective beam areas, ratio for spectral index, etc. So there's all of these tables. There's this chart that I've just shown you on the different ways of going through the different photometry paths. And there's a reference table. And as you go through this, you will see various examples and further tables explaining absolutely everything about how to do point source photometry. And I certainly recommend this chapter of the data reduction guide when you come to doing photometry. However, let's go have a quick look at our observations. So we've processed an observation in height, and one thing we want to look at maybe is the outline down here. These are the levels that Andreas showed you in the slide in the introduction section. If I double click on level 2, I get these point source and extended source calibrated maps. If I double click on that, I will get the map coming up. If I single click, I'll just get this viewer here, which is going to take a little bit to load, but that's it. And then up here is the metadata, so I can start reading all the metadata for this level 2 map, this point source map for the PSW array. Okay, however, I'd like to do some photometry on this map. So to do that, I go to Spire Useful Scripts, and then I select the photometer point source photometry. Now, as I already have my observation, I'm going to comment out this line here, or at least ignore it. So I'm just going to go through this script. Now, what I would do normally is I might want to load my obs ID from, say, the HSA, in which case I would need to define the obs ID and then load it. However, I already have an obs ID because I've reprocessed it. This observation is of a star, alpha tau, so I'm just going to define the alpha, define the array this time for PSW. And then for a little bit of shorthand, just to make some of these lines a little bit less unwieldy, because you have to strip out the level 2 from the observation context. And then you have to strip out the point source map context, and then from that you have to strip out the product. So it's a bit like unpeeling an onion, but this is a short way of just pulling out the map from that whole onion structure. So that's the point source map and the extended map. I define which calibration tree I'm using, so I'm using the latest one, which is 12.3. That's actually already defined. here because it was defined when I reprocessed the observation, so I don't need to do that again. Define, so this calibration context contains lots of products that have all the calibration data. So what I'm doing now is I'm just pulling out the beam correction data, the aperture correction data, and this color correction data. So I now have these tables of all these types of corrections. This just then pulls out the single number I need for my alpha and my array. So again, the beam area, beam correction, color correction, and aperture correction. So we figure out what K4 is by pulling that out, K4E by pulling that out here, and this gives you your K4 P2E by just dividing the two. Then we pull out the, we define the full width path maximum, and we define the aperture radius values. These are the recommended numbers for the radius values. You can define other ones if you wish. And then these are the annulus values for the aperture correction for inner and outer, for the background estimation. Then for the full width half max, we only actually need the one for our array, which is PSW, so you just pull that out here. And again, we only need the radius value for our array, so we pull that out here. That's a format string that just allows you to print it out in a nice way. And then what we have here is a section of the script which shows you how to run SOS Extractor. So you can pull out the WCS, you can define a region of interest. This is optional, you don't have to supply a region of interest, you can run it without. And then you just run source extractor, SOS Extractor on your map. This is a Bayesian, log Bayesian threshold. Set to 5, that means that the detection will be a strong detection of a source. Set to 2.5, that will be a weak detection. So if you just run that, you get here sources. So if you now click on sources, you will see the source, because I defined a small region of interest, I only get one source. You get the RA deck, the X and the Y of the spacecraft, the errors are here, and importantly, the flux, and the flux errors here of the source that you've detected. And then all these background areas, entities as well. So you get the full set of data here in the sources. You can also find sources in this list here somewhere. Oh no, it's under SRC Sussex, right, and then sources. So that's running Sussex Extractor. I've just defined a tight region around my star. So what I'm doing here is getting out the coordinates, applying the color correction, and then finally printing the flux after the color correction now, which is 1150 millijanskis, not the value directly from sources because that wasn't color corrected. Now this is the color corrected flux. I'll just show you quickly the timeline fitter. To run the timeline fitter, you have to use the level 1. So you get that directly out of this observation context. This defines which array you're running it on. Again, the radius. this is the background area that you use. Allowed vary background, you can set that to true or false. Use the background in the fit. Again, the default there is true. And then the input source list is purely option. No, that for this one you have to do it. Sorry, for the timeline for two, you have to define your source list because it's not a source extractor. So you have to define where your source is. So again, you get a sources, click on that, and you can see a flux from this particular fitter. Apply your color correction and print the result. And this is the result from this particular fitter. So this gives you a slightly different flux. This script also shows you how to do the aperture photometry, where you start with the extended map and you divide it by this, you apply this color correction from the ratio of the two colors, and then you convert it into a point source image by using the beam area. And that gets it into Jansky per pixel, which is the units required by the aperture photometry methods. Then to apply aperture photometry, this is what you need. The detector fetch threshold is the same as definition as with SUS extractor, where 5 is a strong detection of the source. Again, you still have to color correct and print out the result. And then this is the two DAO plot methods. First of all, letting it do it for you. Sorry, this is the do aperture correction is false. Sorry, this is the one where you do it yourself. And then this is the one, the one where it does it for you. And finally, there's the aperture photometry. So if you want to use that method, that's the way you have to do it. This 1E to the 3 is just from the point that it comes out with different units to the, this comes out in Jansky's instead of millijanskys, so that just converts it into millijanskys. So I'm not going to say any more about this script, and I'm going to end my presentation here and take any questions.
So, thank you. Very nice presentation and demo again. Last round for questions on the photometer or on the general SPIRE session. So I have one myself. In this diagram where you, this nice flow diagram where you say what to use depending on what kind of circumstances, you say yes. You should use the timeline fitter if sources are brighter than 30 millijanskys, and otherwise you should use standard map detection.
Otherwise you should use SUS extractor.
Yes, but my question is how would you know how bright your sources are before you extract the sources? So what if I don't know?
You might not. You might have to iterate a bit. Remember, you first have to extract the sources with either SUS extractor or DAO plot, and that will give you their flux.
Okay.
So by extracting the sources in the first place, you already know their flux.
Okay.
If you want more accurate photometry on your sources, we would usually recommend that you then use that list of sources as an input source list for the timeline fitter.
Ah, I see. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. So then the workflow, the recommended workflow is to first detect with the SAS extractor and then feed the list to the timeline fitter and then essentially use that. That will give you more accurate fluxes for bright sources, and then you would have to use the SAS extractor fluxes for the fainter sources.
Yes. I mean, to be honest, we're still having internal debates about whether timeline fitter or source extractor is better for paint sources. We're not. It's very difficult to know. Because we don't have standard sources of that flux level. So the only way that we can do this is by injecting our own sources into maps. And the evidence that we're getting is that actually there's not a lot of difference between timeline fitter and Sus extractor even at faint fluxes.
Okay.
But
yeah,
the standard recommendation is Sus extractor at the moment, but the reality is that both timeline fitter and Sus extractor are good down to the, or as good as they are good down to the faint fluxes. I would say that once you start getting below 30 millijanskis, your fluxes are getting quite dodgy anyway.
Okay, yes, I agree. Okay, thanks very much. So it's of course it's a science question. I understand that point. Users need to decide that it's good to get some kind of higher level guidelines to at least to start with, and this is what you have given. So great, thank you. So any other questions? Yes, so we got two more questions. One was from Shan Huang. Can I use the task annular sky aperture photometry to do photometry on map extended level 2 products? If so, corrections included in the task?
Yes. So what I have here is how you do that. So you can see here that I'm using the extended map to do the annular sky photometry. And this is how you would run the task on an extended map.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But so probably after the last part of the question is that you see that after the aperture photometry has been extracted with this annular sky aperture photometry task, there's a second line where it's corrected by the beam, by the aperture, and by the color correction. So those corrections need to be done afterwards.
Yes.
Okay, thanks. And another question from Wang Yi Lin is, can you perform the serial level offset of spire images by using any script in Hive in addition to the Planck data and some specific galactic background models?
Okay, so in the scripts here is a useful script to do the zero point correction. I'm not going to run through this today, but I'm happy to go through it with anybody on the help desk afterwards. One thing you do need, however, to run this script is that you need to download the Planck maps and install them onto your system. So you will put them on your computer, and here you define the path to where those maps are. The Planck maps are given in the, I think they're in the DRG under here maybe. There's a link, here. Do you see this here? So if you go to Absolute Calibration of Spire Maps and just scroll down a little bit, you can see a link to download from the HSC website. So you will need to download those two maps and put them on your local computer somewhere. And then when you run the zero-point correction script, you will need to put that path into the zero-point correction script. And once you've done that, you can run the zero-point correction for yourself.
Okay, excellent. Thanks very much, Tanya. So is there any other question from anyone? Okay, otherwise we will do a short coffee tea break of half an hour. There's one more question, sorry. The same user, Wang Yi Lin, asked whether the same can be also applied to the PAX images.
No, because the Planck data doesn't go to PAX wavelengths. And therefore, you can't. You need to extend anything to PAX through a model which is kind of very. You have to make a lot of assumptions if you try and extend things to PAX wavelengths. You can't use the Planck data directly.
Yeah. Of course, there's good. Okay, thank you. Good. So then we thank everyone, Andreas, Tania, and Ed for the sessions.